Good morning. We are so pumped up that you have tuned in and are planning on worshiping with us today at Woodlawn. Whether you are driving down the road, you've got your family gathered up around the dining room table, or you're just sitting in the living room, we believe that today as we worship, God is going to do something special in your life.
Yes, and if you love what you see here today, don't forget to share us on Facebook, on YouTube, give us likes, give us hearts, comment, and let us know that you're here and share it with everybody else what's going on at Woodlawn.
Absolutely, and if you have a prayer need, if you're watching on YouTube or on Facebook, you can drop it in the comments and we will pray with you about that need. Or additionally, you can visit woodlawnchurch.cc/connect and just drop us some information about yourself and we will be praying and believing with you. Once again, thank you for joining us this morning. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be amazing. I know God is going to do something great in your life, in your family's life. And don't forget, you belong here.
This started with an idea. Somehow, if we were given the opportunity, we could become more. If given the place and the time, we could build a nation where everyone could become more. We prayed for favor. We believed that out of many, we could become one. Though America was never simple, our nation did not give in or give up. We crawled, strived for dreams and freedoms we believed in, fought to hold hands as we learned to stand on our own. We are brothers and sisters. Our dreams are not dimmed by our tears. We have stumbled, but will not fall. It began with the idea that beliefs should not be dictated. Freedom was to be shared. Worship was the right of the individual, not the responsibility of the government. All of these things were self-evident. We knew it in our hearts. They were inalienable for everyone, endowed by our Creator, God-given. On this day, we remember our freedom, and we thank the God who provided it. May God bless America.
God bless America. To the prairies, to the oceans, white with foam. God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
Good morning, Woodlawn Church family. We hope that you are well. We thank you for joining us today online. We pray that God would have his way right where you're at. Thank you, Jesus, for your goodness, God. We love you, Lord. We bless your name today. Thank you, Jesus.
Step into the joy of the Lord.
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 Step into the joy of the Lord. and hungry for more.
Welcome to Woodlawn Church. We are so honored to have you a part of our online service today. If you would like to connect with us or if you have a prayer need, click the link below or visit us at woodlawnchurch.cc/connect. We'd love to hear from you.
I just want to say thank you for being so faithful to God's kingdom during this crisis, during this time, and you've been faithful in your giving. And I'm sure today will be no different. There are three convenient ways for you to give. You can go to our website, woodlawnchurch.cc, click on the Give tab, and it will lead you through the steps. Or you can download the Church Center app right from your Apple or Android phone. And after you click on this app, it will lead you through the process. And lastly, you can text to give. 84321, just put the dollar amount, and it will lead you through the steps. Thank you for being faithful. One thing that we love to do here at Woodlawn, we do it every Sunday, is we declare the promises of God over our lives, over our finances, and I want you to join with us today as we do just that. So get your family, get your kids, and join with us as we declare God's promises. Let's begin. Upon the authority and by the orders of your word, I have given. And it shall be given to me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I bring my tithe and offering to you. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked and the curse is broken. I receive your blessings and the abundance that comes with them. I receive jobs and promotions, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, bills paid off, and debts dismissed. I decree that my whole family will be saved and walk with God in health, abundance, and in divine favor and blessings. I shall be blessed going in, I shall be blessed going out, and all that I do will prosper in Jesus' name. Amen. And it is so. Amen. I believe that, and we declare that over our lives today.
I've searched the world, but it could fill me. And man's empty praise, the treasures that fade, are never enough. You came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you see them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better.
There's nothing nothing is better than you.
Help us sing that. Come on, say there's nothing.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing.
You mercy will restore me. I will proclaim, even if the world may fall before me, I will proclaim. For when you found me, you healed me, you called me from the grave, you gave me a real love.
Good morning. It is an honor to be with you today. You might be disappointed that the pastor's not here, but he has given me this opportunity this Sunday morning to share with you what I feel and my spirit on my heart today. We know we're living in perilous times, different times, and we just want to thank you for logging on today and certainly love and appreciate the Woodlawn Church family. Our prayers are with every one of you that has been affected by COVID-19. Continue to pray for you that God will give you a quick recovery. And here we are, the first Sunday in the month of July. It's hard to believe that half of the year has come and gone. And what a time it has been. None of us saw this coming. But here we are, beginning the last half of the year. Only God knows what we are looking at in the next few months. But I know God is going to give us strength. He's going to give us courage. And He will be with us. And I do believe great things are in store for this church. We welcome all of our guests that are not Woodlawn members. Thank you for joining us today. And I feel God has given me a word for this church, and I want to share it with you. I will do my best to respect your time, but it has been quite a while, so that may be at your disadvantage. But I feel compelled to preach on a subject that I am not the best representative on this particular subject. I sense the Spirit is saying to the church with alarm bells sounding loud in my spirit, it's time to pray. All I want to accomplish this morning is to help you in your prayer life. I believe it is the missing ingredient in the life of a believer for a spiritual awakening. The Apostle Paul said, "You and I are divine masterpieces. Your life was meant to be fulfilled and finished. Prayer is what will get you to the finish line. We must finish the race." Whatever happened to prayer? Or I could say, what has happened to us as a church? The third millennium dawned with such hope and promise, such noble aspiration, was quickly dashed by events such as 9/11 and the seemingly never-ending war on extremism and the rise of radical ideology and the erosion of moral and spiritual strongholds. The fabric of our world seemed stretched to the breaking point. A new day has come, but it's already evening. as the day of creation began in the evening, so does this pivotal day. The shadow lengthens. The darkness gather. As most fowl roost when the sun sets, believers have likewise folded their wings of faith and prayer. Yes, we sense increasing chaos around the corner. Mayhem creeps like a toxic fog over the hearts of men. Anxiety has come, and it seemed it would just not leave. Other uninvited guests with names like violence, hatred, prejudice, strife has seized our national attention. Believers struggle to come grips with these seemingly rapid changes. Many churches struggle to survive in a culture gone haywire. In one generation, we have seen the most significant moral collapse witnessed in our nation's history. The loosening of sexual mores in the 60s were profound. We have observed a 300% rise in illegitimate births. Over 50 million in one generation that has been aborted. One in every two marriages ending in divorce. The collapsing of morals in music, media, we could say popular entertainment, and the rise in any number of social ills. The United States seems has followed the path of Europe. Only 20% of America adults attend church on a regular basis. Some 94% of churches are either plateaued or declining. Only 6% of churches are growing. Thousands of churches are up for sale at any given moment in the United States. We may take some degree of comfort that this could be different in the realm of spirit-filled churches and truth-loving churches. Yet, before we get too complacent, we need to take a long look at ourselves. Are we reaching, teaching, and discipling the lost? What about our own lives? Are we more satisfied with our walk with God today than we were yesterday? Have we grown discouraged and set aside our own diligence and discipline in pursuing the face of God? Are you still with me? If we can be vulnerable and transparent this morning, we can admit that something is wrong. We suffer from a pervasive sickness that pierces beneath the fifth rib and plunges right into the human heart. I would diagnose it this way. We suffer from acute prayerlessness. We can talk about prayer, but we don't pray. We can read about prayer, but we don't pray. We can hear about prayer and even preach about prayer, but we don't pray. We're sick. It's terminal. It's stage 4 called prayerlessness. How do we get this disease? Prayerless people contract this disease through the twin viruses of doubt and apathy. People with no or little faith do not pray. In their heart of hearts, they do not really believe God and that God is a rewarder of them who diligently seek Him. The writer of Hebrews chapter 11 makes this statement. Speaking of the heart, prayerless people compromise their immune system by allowing lesser love to consume their every waking moment. We talk to those we love. So our silence with God is very alarming. God is a measure of our loveless condition. Much faith plus much love equals much prayer. Little faith plus little love equals little prayer. No faith plus no love equals no prayer. It's just as simple as 2 + 2 = 4. People who really love God wants to talk to Him and be with Him on a daily basis. To be honest, very blunt, outside of formal prayers at meals and bedtimes, few people pray at all. But prayer has no substitute. It must always exist in the lives of God's people. Every generation must build its own altars and illuminate the darkness that is around them. We're busier, more productive, and supremely entertained than ever before. Yet, ladies and gentlemen, we struggle to juggle the vital components of our lives. It's family, it's relationship, it's jobs, it's finances, it's possession. And you see, God fits somewhere into this, but we struggle perpetually to figure out where does He fit into this agenda. We let the urgent things crowd out what we view to be necessary. Prayerlessness is killing us. We believe in prayer, but we don't pray as we could and as we should. Consequently, ladies and gentlemen, we have prayerless churches. We have prayerless homes. We have prayerless parents. We have prayerless children. We have prayerless preachers. We have prayerless singers. We have prayerless musicians. We have prayerless volunteers. If we're not careful, church going becomes a substitute for our church being. Having good church becomes the focus, not being the church. We cannot be the church without being prayerful. Our pastor has been preaching about walking the walk. Last Sunday, he addressed walking in faith. You see, you can't walk in faith without walking in the Spirit. And you can't walk in the Spirit without a prayer life. Jude 1, verse 20 said it this way, "But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost." Paul said, "I will pray with my understanding, but I will pray in the Spirit." It's nothing like praying in the Spirit. That is the only way you can build your faith. Amen. Jesus said in Matthew 21:13, and He said unto them, "It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer." I wonder today how many churches can be really looked at as a house of prayer. The cure for prayerlessness is intentional prayerfulness. Hallelujah. We must stir ourselves from slumber. We must be renewed that we may stretch our wings and fly again. We need the wings of personal prayer, our long time with God. We need the wings of united prayer, our one another time with God. Personal prayer, united prayer, prayer in twos and threes, and prayers in large groups, the kind of prayer that will turn the world upside down. Don't take my word for it. Listen to past voices on this subject. Let me share it with you. C.H. Spurgeon writes, he said it this way, "My own soul conviction is that prayer is the grandest power in the entire universe, that it has a more omnipresent force than electricity, attractions, gravitation, or any of those other secret forces which men have called by name, but which they do not understand." E.M. Bounds said it this way, "The more praying there is in the world, the better the world will be, the mightier the forces against evil." Andrew Murray said, where there is much prayer, there will be much of the Spirit. And when there is much of the Spirit, there will be an ever increasing prayer. Samuel Chadwick said, the one concern of the devil is to keep Christians from praying. He said, he fears nothing from prayerless studies, prayerless works, prayerless religion. He laughs at our toil. He mocks at our wisdom, but he is troubled when we pray. R.A. Torrey said, there has been revival without much preaching, but there has never been a mighty revival without mighty praying. It was said that Nero fiddled while Rome burned. May we not look back and say, we piddle as the world burned. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, we must rise up and seize the moment that God has given us. God awaits our voice. When a child is born, a mother awaits a cry. The baby's cry provides an evidence of a clear airway and functioning lungs. The baby can breathe and is capable of surviving in the outside world. Ladies and gentlemen, God awaits to hear the voice of his children. Our cry to him indicates we have received the power to survive and thrive in the world. We recognize he is our source and he is our strength. Through faith in him, we can overcome our world. Oswald Chambers said, prayer is not a normal part of the life of a natural man. We hear it said that a person's life will suffer if he doesn't pray, but I question that. What will suffer is the life of the Son of God in us, which is nourished not by food, but by prayer. He said, when a person is born again from above, the life, the Spirit of the Son of God is born in him, and he can either starve or nourish it. Amen. Jesus makes this statement, the book of John, chapter 15, verse 5. Apart from me, you can do nothing. He said, I'm the vine, you're the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Let me close with this. I feel such a challenge and such a desire in these times that, you know, it appears we got more time now than we've ever had. Like I told someone the other day, I'm up, dressed, ready to go, and nowhere to go. What a great opportunity it is to spend some of this time in prayer. God has changed my life in prayer the last few months. I've always believed in prayer and I've always tried to practice prayer, but something is happening. And I believe in this hour that we're living in, we must pray like we've never prayed before. Matthew 25, Jesus, near the end of his ministry, looking at the cross, and he shares some very, very important stories with his chosen one. And he gives us this beautiful story of the 10 virgins. 5 were wise, 5 were foolish. We understand that. They were unwise in the fact that they did not really seemingly concerned about the coming of the bridegroom. They wanted to be there. They wanted to participate, but they didn't make preparation. And I want to give you 5 reasons I believe the 5 foolish virgins were not ready. We look at the 5 wives, those that went in, but then there was 5 virgins who appeared to be a part of the bride, be a part of the celebration, but they were very foolish. Number one, they didn't adequately check their lamps in the daytime, a daily walk. Number 2, they were trying to get by with the least that they needed, and they did not take any extra oil. Number three, they assumed that they could make it on someone else's oil. Number four, they were not willing to pay the price until it was too late. The fifth reason, they had not been spending enough time with the bridegroom. Ladies and gentlemen, I do believe we're living in the last days. He's coming. No man knows the day nor the hour. But I do believe the only one that will be going in the rapture of the church when he comes will be those who are watching, waiting, and praying with anticipation. Those are the ones he is going to appear and bring them with him. I pray this morning that something has spoken into your spirit, the urgency of the hour, and how important it is to stay ready for that time, that event. No man knows the day and the hour, but we just know one thing. God is coming. And I don't know about you, but I want to hear him say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Would you pray with me? There in your home, if you have those that are with you, none of us have prayed enough. We've all fallen short, but it's never too late to start over. It's never too late to begin a different day, a different approach to living for God. I want to be able to hear his voice. I want to be able to walk in the Spirit daily. There's so many needs around us, but if we don't pray, there is no way we can minister to those that are in need. Woodlawn Church family, I pray that we can be known as a church of prayer. He said, pray without ceasing. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you today for the opportunity to speak to those that would have been a part of this broadcast. Lord Jesus, we know we're living in crucial times. This is a crucial moment. And I just thank you, God, that you have allowed us to be here for such a time as this. We do believe there's coming a great harvest. We believe there's going to be a great revival. But we know one thing, we must do our part, and that is become servants of prayer. Pray like we have never prayed before. Put you first in everything we do and say. God, it is so easy for all of us to get so busy with life, and we have good intentions, but somehow we allow these things that seems important to affect our life and affect our prayer life. God, I just pray for everyone today. Yes, we repent before you. Yes, we have fallen short. But oh God, it's not how we start, it's how we finish, and we want to finish strong. I pray for our church family. I pray for all those that are sick, been affected by this virus, so many families, special needs in our church. Brother Mike Triggs, Sister Jeanette Wallace, others that need a healing touch in their body. God, we just people of prayer. We're going to continue to pray and bombard heaven. We just know, God, all things work together for good to them who love you and are called according to your purpose. We pray in the only name, the matchless name, the name of Jesus, for we know it is a strong tower and the righteous runneth into it and are safe. God, I pray for our pastor and wife and family. Continue to give them strength as they lead this great church, God, into a time of a mighty revival. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And could everyone say amen. God bless you. It's been an honor to be with you this morning.
God's voice is so much louder and more powerful than our chaos. I'm so thankful that we can stand on the promises of God's word. He's for us and he's with us.
Absolutely. And if you were encouraged, maybe you were challenged by today's message, we want to let you know that we are a church that believes that God is always trying to push you forward and you have a next step. So I invite you, why don't you visit woodlawnchurch.cc/connect And there you can begin the journey of taking that next step. Maybe you want to know more about repentance, baptism, the Holy Spirit, or maybe you just want to dive deeper into God's Word, or you have a prayer need. You have someone you just want to talk with. We are ready to connect with you. So please visit woodlawnchurch.cc/connect and be ready to take that next step today.
Yes, once again, thank you so much for joining us. And don't forget, you belong here.